Hello everyone and welcome to We Meet at Digital Days. My name is Lisa Richter and I will moderate this presentation. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our virtual conference. The topic of this presentation is Single Pair Ethernet, Filter Design Considerations and Power over Data Line. Our speaker is Martin Leinseder. He will hold the presentation and will answer your questions. Before we start, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the presentation. This means that you cannot ask questions via your microphone during the presentation. Nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask questions during the presentation at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the control panel. This presentation will be about 30 minutes long. The chat questions will be answered in a Q&A session following the webinar. There are 5 to 10 minutes in addition scheduled for this. If we are unable to answer all of your questions within this time, we will answer them via email afterwards. If you still have any other questions left, just mail us at exhibition@we-online.com. We will try to answer all of your questions promptly. At the end of the webinar, you'll be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you take the time to fill out the survey and help us to improve our event. You will receive the link to the presentation in the next few days. The recording will be available at our website shortly. So now I will hand over to our speaker, Martin, and I wish you a good presentation.
So thank you, Lisa, and hello, everyone from my side. My name is Martin Leinseder, and I will talk about single pair Ethernet, or more into detail, single pair Ethernet filter design. First, the agenda for today's meeting. I start with an introduction of the single pair Ethernet filtering. So what kind of filters we have? Not only single pair Ethernet, also other filters, why we need a filter. And then I go over to the different filter solutions that we can have for single pair Ethernet. There are two I want to show you. One is for 10 base T1, one is for 100 base T1, followed by power over data line, also here 10 base T1 and 100 base T1. Gigabit, so 1000 base T1 is still missing. This is because we're still working on a solution here. Maybe later when it's time, then I can also give some details here. So when we talk about single pair Ethernet and when we talk about single pair Ethernet filtering, we not talk, of course, about the Ethernet that you have in your office, because in the industry, the environment is more harsh and the requirements are different. So when we look at some machine hall, like we can see in this picture here, then we can see many different devices. We can see robots, machines, we can sensors, actuators, cameras, and shielding cabinets, and everywhere there is data communication. And so many different bus systems are inside of this machine hall. This leads to a problem now, because nowadays we have more and more communication. It's not only that one machine is producing signals and is communicating. No, every machine is communicating with each other. And in some way, maybe the engineer is sitting in his office and needs to check all the data of the machines. And so there's many data going on from the sensor to the cloud. And this data needs to be it needs to be simple transported. And at the moment, this is not always possible. When we look at this picture here, we can see some device inside a machine. Here we have a LAN connection from the different devices, but also we have other connections like RS-232. So there are other protocols running. And this could be a problem. Or what means problem? It makes the things a bit more complicated, because when you have a sensor and you use another protocol, then you need to translate this protocol on a certain point. You have to have a gateway that the signals can be transported with Ethernet into the cloud. And this makes it more complicated as more communication is going on in the industry. And this can become, and single per Ethernet should change that, because with single per Ethernet, you should be able to have one communication system from the sensor to the cloud. So now I want to talk about the filtering of single per Ethernet. Why we need a filtering at all? To see this, I show you how filtering looks like for another bus system. I show you the Profibus. And Profibus normally or often is connected with an RS-232 connector. And then we have the filtering here. And on the left side here, there is another connector. But in the realistic case, there would be a chip. And what we can see here in the middle is a very dominant element. This is the cam mode choke. We have also several capacitors here around, and ESD protection. This is also what you can see on the right side. On the right side, this is the schematic to that. And what we have, this is the cam mode choke. This is for EMI filtering. This is for common mode signals coming mostly from the cable to filter this. Here we have the VDD channel, and also here we have a P filter inside to filter all the noise coming over this channel. The same that we can see for Profibus, we also can see for Ethernet. Also here we need a filtering. When we look at the picture, we can see on the left-hand side, this is the RJ45 connector, followed by the filtering. Also, you can see this on the right picture. This here, all this block, these four transformers and cam mode chokes, this is the filtering for Ethernet. Yeah, the transformer, this is the galvanic isolation of 1.5 kV. And we have four cam mode choke, one for each channel, also followed by TVS diodes. And then afterwards, these signals, they go to the PHY chip. This means the connector and the discrete line transformer, where the filters are included with the TVS diodes, this is the MDI. Yeah? And this here, this is the PHY chip. Also on the board, you can see there's a power supply. This is just for testing reasons, as we wanted to power up the PHY chip. And so we designed an extra power supply here. But in general, you can say, okay, there's the MDI and the chip afterwards. For single per Ethernet, you can see many similarities on that. Also here, we can see the MDI, where we can see the connector. And then we have a transformer and a filtering. In our case, we only have one channel, yeah, because it's single pair Ethernet. So this means we only need one transformer. Why we need a transformer, I will explain you later. Then in this particular file chip, we have an RxTx mixing. This is because of signal collision that the signals always take the right path, followed by a PHY chip. And here we have a microchip inside. This is always coming after the PHY chip, so that the signals can be written out. And here the power supply, this is also the power supply for the PHY chip and the microchip. Here we see a detailed picture now of the filtering on the left-hand side. This is first the connection with LAN. Here the connector is on the right side and the PHY chip is on the left side. And in the middle is the filtering. And you can see when you compare the size that the filtering of single pair Ethernet, of course, is much smaller because we only have one channel. On the right side, this is the picture more into detail. This is a marketing picture more or less, so you can see a very sharp corner here between the transformer and the capacitor. This is of course not realistic, but I show you later some more realistic pictures. So now I gave you an overview about the single pair Ethernet filtering, but what is inside? What exactly are the components that we need for the single pair Ethernet filtering? And for that, I will go to the next slide and I show you this. This is the filtering that you know maybe out of different application nodes or file chip data sheets. Here we see this is typically that on the right side we have the connector, and this is an automotive connector. Yeah, in for single pair Ethernet for the industry we would have a slightly different connector, but never mind. On the left side there is the file chip, and then we have a CAM mode choke. This is also the same, and then we have as a galvanic isolation two capacitors, and these two capacitors they have 100 nanofarad in capacity, and normally they have a galvanic isolation of 50 volt. This 50 volt, this is okay for automotive, but as single pair Ethernet is in the industrial sector, we have the same rules that we have for the standard Ethernet, and here we need to comply according to the norm IEC 62368-1, or the old norm, the current norm is IEC 60950-1, and this means we need 1.5 kilovolt of isolation, and this isolation needs to hold for 1 minute. Of course, there are cases also in the industry where you can use capacitor solutions with the 50 volt isolation. This is there where only professional people can touch into the system. Yeah, only workers on the system. For example, yeah, if you are in a shielding cabinet or something, and this is protected against external influences. Now I want to talk about 10 base T1, because what we figured out in our research is that we have different filtering based on how fast is the data rate. And now I'm talking about 10 base T1 and especially 10 base T1L, and this is the 10 base T1, so 10 megabit per second over 1,000 meters. And if we see the requirements out of the IEEE, then we can see here, this is the return loss. This is the blue curve here. And then we can see the mode conversion loss. So these two are the MDI requirements. There's the chapter MDI requirements. The challenge for this return loss, especially, and also the mode conversion loss, this is the lower frequency. So from zero, so 100 kilohertz until 1 megahertz. So this makes it a bit complicated for us to handle, as you can see in the next slides, but we found solutions for that. What we did is that we took this design from automotive Ethernet, and then we tried to change that so that we can hold this 2 kV or 1.5 kV isolation for 1 minute. And so we did certain tests here. On the left-hand side, we took the design from automotive Ethernet. So we have two capacitors with 50 volt, and we have the CAM mode choke. But you can see that the CAM mode choke is quite big when we compare it with the connectors. This is because we are working in deep frequencies, especially the 100 kilohertz up to 1 megahertz. This is very challenging, and so we need a very high inductance in lower frequencies. And this high inductance, this makes that we need a lot of core material, a lot of windings, and so this CAM mode choke gets large. In the middle, we made the same, but here in this schematic we can see that the capacitors are now larger. We took capacitors also with 100 nanofarad, but this time the capacitors can hold 2 kV of isolation. And of course, the CAM mode choke will stay the same with the size. And on the right side, we have the same solution, but in this case, we use the signal transformer. Why we use the signal transformer? When we look at the signal, the frequencies for 10 base T1 from 100 kilohertz to 20 kilohertz, then we can say, this is quite similar to what we have for 100 base T for the standard Ethernet. There the frequency limit is 31.5 megahertz. We can see, okay, this is quite similar, to what we got. So let's try transformer. And after what we tried, we can see those are the results. In this case, here we show the return loss. And you cannot see it from the graph, but I will tell you this starts from 100 megahertz. And here there's the first break or the first changing at 1 megahertz, and this is 10 megahertz. So this is a logarithmic scale here on the epsilon axis. And what we see, especially what I told you at the lower frequencies, there are some curves and they go very closely to the limit that we have from the IEEE 802.3 CG. And now we zoom a bit closer. And what does this mean? There we can see, two curves are going very close. And I can tell you these two curves, these are the capacitor solutions. So the gray one, this is the 50 volt capacitor. The black one, this is the 2 kV capacitor. And the red one, this is the transformer solution. And yeah, what we can see clearly, this 50 volt solution and 2 kV solution with the capacitors, they're too close maybe to the limit. And so with the tolerances that we have at the different parts, we cannot be sure that we always not hit this limit of the IEEE. The transformer has a good distance, so this is safer for the return loss. When we look at the mode conversion loss and the limit, then we see that all of the curves have a certain distance. Here, the capacitor solutions have their advantage. They are more far away from the limit of the IEEE 802.3, but every curve has at least 30 dB difference, even more. By the way, here, the limit of the IEEE 802.3, this minus 25 dB, I was told by a colleague from another company that this limit is not so realistic. He said from his measurements and calculations, a limit of minus 45 dB is more realistic to see. But anyway, even if we have minus 45 dB, still every curve is has a certain distance to the limit. And this is the schematic of the single pair Ethernet that we took. I will explain you in short words what is this schematic here. So at first we have the transformer here. This is in the middle. The transformer, this is the galvanic isolation of 1.5 kV. But not only the galvanic isolation, of course, he needs to transfer the signals from the connector to the PHY chip and back. But also we have some capacitors inside and a ground termination. First of all, this capacitor C2, this is a blocking capacitor and it's for EMI coming from the PHY chip. So the PHY chip, normally a single pair Ethernet signal is going from plus 1 volt to minus 1 volt, plus minus 1 volt, or plus minus 2 volt, but a PHY chip cannot send negative signals. So instead, he's sending the signals plus an offset. And so that this offset voltage is not belated to ground. There we have this capacitor and this is blocking. And the transformer, it only the differential signals will go over the transformer and the other signals will be blocked. So before of the transformers, we, for example, have maybe 3 volts plus and plus 1 volt. And after the transformer is plus minus 1 volt again. Then we have the capacitor C3. And the capacitor C3, this is made in between the two middle pins. And this has a special function. And this is because of the low frequencies for 10 base T1, this 100 kilohertz to 1 megahertz. If we put this capacitor inside, then we can go to these deep frequencies. If we not put this, then the limit, then the curve would be much more closely to the limit of the IEEE 802.3. And this, what you have R1 and C1, this is what you know from the LAN transformers. This is This is at the ground termination. This capacitor C1, this is a 2 kV capacitor for blocking reasons, for DC voltage blocking reasons. Yeah. Then we have here the TVS diode, D1. Normally you would say why this TVS diode is so close to the file chip and not on the connector side. If you ask this, then I give you right. Yeah, normally the TVS diodes should be as close as to the connector as possible. So on the right side, but you need to consider if you do hypo tests and you do the hypo test from the signal pins here to the ground, sorry, then all the voltage would be would go over the D1 TVS diode, and so you would have a breakthrough. And to avoid this, you can either put D1 to the file chip side, or that you only test from the connector side to the file chip side, the signals, but not from connector side to the ground. Yeah. And here, this is what I explained you, the capacitor C3. Sometimes the transformers have no possibility that you split a middle pin. In this case, you can do another thing, and this is that you, instead of capacitor C3, you use two capacitors with the same value, and you put them on the side of the transformer. An interesting thing after we were finished with our design was that we went in contact with IC houses and presented our solutions there. And first of all, the IC houses said, okay, this is a very good job. You with electronic, you could manage that you're far away from the IEEE limits. This is good. But there is one thing you need to consider. And this is in the IEEE, there is a chapter that talks about the transmission. And here there is something interesting. This is the transmitter output droop. And this chapter says, if the droop, if there's an output droop of the file chip, if you put them into test mode 2, and if this output droop is more than 10% measured on the connector, then this would be not allowed from the IEEE. And what is meant with that, you can see on the right side, we managed it to measure this. And this was not easy because we first needed a file chip. And thanks to an IC house, we could get a 10BASE-T1 file chip. We had to program it, and then we had to put this file chip into test mode 2. And what I mean is what you can see here. These are the flanks from the file chip. And this is measured after the discrete filtering. And after a certain time, after the top of the signal, this is 133 nanoseconds, there we have a measure point and 612, sorry, I cannot see, there's something in front. Yeah. Let's say after another certain time, there we have a droop. And this droop should not be exceeding 10%. In this case, when we calculate this, then we have a droop of 10.2%. So this droop here, this would be too much. So we had to change our design a little bit or adapt it. And what we figured out, at the end, the solution was quite easy. Before we had capacitor C1 and C2 of 100 or 200 nanofarad, and then we had to increase it to 570 nanofarad. And this made that we could decrease the droop after the transformer to under 6%. And here you see the picture how this can look like, this MDI. So on the right side, this is the connector for single pair Ethernet. This is quite a very small connector. If you see this in real life, and then we have the black component, this is the transformer. This has a length of 4.5 millimeters. And then these are the two capacitors, C1 and C2. Here, this is the bigger capacitor, 2 kV, going to the ground. And the TVS diode is not in the picture as far as I can see. Yeah. Right. Then I talk about 100 base T1 because, yeah, this is also an interesting case, the 10 times higher speed, but of course not a cable length of 1000 meter. Here the limit at the moment is on 40 meters. And here what you can see, this is the limit again from the IEEE 802.3. Now this is the 802.3 BW. And the challenge here, this is not the lower frequencies. The challenge here, this is the mode conversion loss and the higher frequencies here. So we have to be stable up to 200 megahertz. And again, we did a test on that and we used the solution from automotive Ethernet. And on the left side, you can see what is the advantage of automotive Ethernet of the two capacitors. Now they get very small, and this means the price of these capacitors is quite cheap. And this makes it interesting, of course, for the automotive industry. Also, the Kamocho can be smaller now as we not go into these deep frequencies of 100 kilohertz. In the middle, we have the same solution, but now we have two capacitors with 2 kV, of course, to test it. And on the right side, the transformer solution. Now we have a small difference here. We have not capacitor C3 in between the two middle pins, and we have an additional Kamo choke because what I didn't tell you before is that the transformer itself can lead Kamo signals to ground. And this is the reason why we don't need a Kamo choke for 10 base T1, but for 100 base T1, as the signals are faster, we need a Kamo choke for higher frequencies. And this is the result that we had from our measurements. And you can see for the return loss, we have an advantage again for the capacitor solutions, at least at up to 20 megahertz. After 20 megahertz, then also the transformer solution is in between the 50 volts capacitors and the 2 kV capacitors. But also with the transformer, we have a certain distance from the IEEE 802.3. And when we look now at the mode conversion loss, then we again can see something interesting. First, at low frequencies, everything seems to be good, but at higher frequencies, starting at 30 megahertz, there we see that at least the 50 volt capacitor solution goes very closely to the limit of the IEEE. And if I zoom a bit closer, then you can see this more into detail. Yeah, so we are very close here. The 2 kV capacitor solution and the transformer solution have more distance from the limit of the IEEE 802.3. And here you can see what does this means also for the PCB size that you need. On the left side, like I said, this is the very compact 50 volt capacitor solution. In the middle, this is the 2 kV capacitor solution. And on the right side, this is the transformer solution. Now I like to talk about power over data line. This chapter is quite new because when I first had this presentation in spring, we haven't got these measurements from power over data line, but here now I can tell you more. Power over data line. This is similar or has similarities to power over Ethernet. So you have a power source, and this is this this area here, this is the power source. So the power comes inside from a cable, and we have the data. This is of course simplified. Yeah, you have not the power from this power supply with 230 volt. No, of course in between you have a AC/DC converter, so that for power over Ethernet or power over data line you have 57 volt only. And here you mix this data and signal, and then this mixed data and power goes over the cable, and this will be splitted on the powered device again into data and signal, into data and power, so that you can empower your devices like a camera here and have your data communication. When we talk about power over data line, I like to also show you power over Ethernet. So this is the Ethernet, the same thing like power over Ethernet. What I like to say is the signals normally go over the transformer. So from the right side, from the cable to the file chip, there you see over the transformer, there's the signal. For Ethernet, we have two channels. So we have transmission and receive channel. And so this is how the signals are going. The power over Ethernet is not going over the transformer because this is more DC signal. And so this voltage, this current will be blocked and go over the transformer middle pin to another circuit. And there's a DC-DC converter. And then you can transport the signal that you need for power supply of your camera or other devices. Why I tell you this? Because for power over data line, this is a bit different. First of all, I show you here, this is the schematic for power over data line. This is the power source, this area, and this is the powered device. And here we have, so the signals, they go from file chip to file chip. So they go from the left side to the right side and back. And here we can see our power. This is the power source. And here is the power device. And the signals, they go over the cable. But they don't go deep in contact, or they cannot go in contact with the transformer here. And yeah, this is here again the blue line from file chip to file chip. The schematic that we drew here, this is made by SPICE. So this is why we have this scene here. This is quite a simulation of the file chip, and also here the resistors as a signal sink. But what I want to tell you is the interesting thing that the current of power over data line is not going over the transformer. And the reason for that is capacitor C3, because capacitor C3 is blocking this current. And so this means no matter how big, how high the current is, it doesn't go over the transformer. And so the transformer doesn't need to get bigger. Yeah. Normally a transformer needs to be bigger for higher current as it can go into saturation. Yeah. And here as the transformer, as the signal doesn't go, or the power doesn't go over the transformer, we always can take the same transformer type. Not need to change the article number or something. Also here, we would recommend, so we drew the C3 inside the circuit, we would recommend that we that you put instead of C3 a capacitor C4 and C5 on your circuit. And the reason is and these capacitors, they should have a voltage of 100 volt. So why we need 100 volt? The signal of power over data line is 57 volts only. So why we need more? The reason is that when the capacitors are in the signal line and the full current is on the capacitors, then also there's a certain voltage on the capacitors. If we have, let's say, 48 volt on each line, then this makes 24 volt at capacitor C4 and 24 volt at capacitor C5. And then we would have a drop in the capacity with this DC bias. And this means at 24 volt, we would have a 16% of drop of the capacitance for the capacitors. And therefore we need this high capacitance, of course, for the capacitors and this 100 volt, so that the drop on the capacitors is not that high. Then we have U3 and U4. These are not cam mode chokes, these are differential mode chokes. You also can take two single chokes. So this means instead of this component U3, you can take two single filters here, and the same for U4. Both are the same components here. And these components, you can see in this picture, they need to be quite large, especially if you apply a high current. And this is because the inductance needs to be high for this power line. And with a rated voltage, rated current of, in this case, 1.5 amp, this choke gets quite large. Of course, the size is smaller if you not need to go to the limit of power over data line, if you only need devices that need 5 watt or something, then of course this component can be much smaller. But you can see that this component is very dominant in the schematic. On the right side, this is the single pair Ethernet connector. On the left side, this is the signal transmission. These are the filters, and almost the biggest component, this is the power choke inside. This is from our simulations that we did with power over data line. So here you see the limits from the IEEE again for the return loss, and in the same color, this is the simulation. So we have a good distance between simulation and between the limit of the IEEE and what we have simulated. And the same for mode conversion loss. Also here we have a certain distance. And in blue, this is not a parameter of the IEEE, but it's important to know that this is the CAM mode rejection. Also here you should try to be better than 30 decibel up to your on your frequency range. And this is what we have here for 10 base D1. So the curve looks quite good. And here the same case for 100 base T1. Also here we simulated we took a quite large choke for high currents. As I said before, the choke can be also smaller if the current is not so high. If you're interested to have more details on that, what you need if you not need to apply so much current and what this means for the choke, you can contact us. And again, here we made some simulation on that. And also here we have a distance between the limit and the simulation of the return loss and the mode conversion loss. That you cannot say, oh, we only did simulations and we did not make measurements. Also, we did measurements now. And these are the measurements, the real ones that we did. This is the mode conversion loss here, and so here we are also on we have also good values for the measurements as we have for the simulations. If you need more information about single pair Ethernet and the filtering, for that we have a landing page on www.we-online.com/SPE for single pair Ethernet. And if you make the same but /ANP085, then you also find an application note. There's very useful information how we did our measurements, more calculations about what I talked before. This application note will be available in a couple of days. So end of the week, if you click inside, you should be able to see it. That's it from my presentation for now. Thank you to all listeners. And if you have questions, please feel free to ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin, for your great presentation. I think we can just take a look at the questions from you all. So the first question is, what about passive components for 1000 base minus T1?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. This is what I said before, but it's good that there's the questions. So right now we have a challenge, and the challenge is the high frequency range for 1000 base T1. In the IEEE, we need to have a mode conversion loss of, I think, minus 55 dB, and this needs to go high up to maybe up to 600 megahertz. And this is very challenging, especially for the transformer. And at the moment, we search for a solution for that. Here we, at the moment, even the capacitor solution cannot hold the limits of the IEEE. So we still need a bit time to improve our solution. So what we need to do is that we reduce everything what is parasitic effect. So we need to reduce parasitic capacitance, and also the German word would be Streuinduktivität. So we need to have a new generation of transformers maybe, and we are in the middle of the process to improve here. But I think also soon you will have some news on that.
Okay, thank you. So, cost to the time, I think we have to finish the presentation now. Mm-hmm. If there are any questions left now, we will answer them via email afterwards, or you can send them to us to exhibition@we-online.com. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed our presentation. The next presentation topic is passive components introduction of new products. See you there and enjoy our digital days. Goodbye.
Thank you all. Have a nice day. Bye.